Jon Levine, thank you for coming on the show. Dude, no, we got a toast. We got a toast because we're a long way with your margarita. There you go. Bing. Jon Levine in the studios right now. Welcome to the Ramil Podcast. Thank you for doing this. Dude, where do we start? Oh, my God. From Miami fucking dumpster shows to Hollywood performances, dude. Oscar,
right. The Academy. I don't know which Academy. But some academy. Right?
One of those, dude, is going to give you a one of those prizes right after, for sure, your last performance, not only as one of the McDonalds brothers, but on Cobra Kai, killing the game. Now, before we get started, you and I go back maybe 5 years?
Yeah, I mean, I got into the comedy game down in South Florida like 2013, maybe?
Okay.
In that neighborhood, 2014, somewhere on. So, I mean, that was 6 years ago.
Right around that time. Yeah. So did I. Yeah. The old Miami, Miami Improv.
Yep.
I don't specifically, I can't remember one specific show because I'm sure we've done plenty, but I believe we've done Berezito. Did you ever do Berezito in South Beach?
I don't think I have. That wasn't the hair salon one, was it? Was that? No, that was.
Hair salon was Maurizio and these people.
Yes.
Which I think we've done too. We've done the improv a few times.
Yeah.
And from going from that to you packing your bags, getting the fuck out of Miami, having enough, if you will. What year did you
2016.
Try to better your life? What is it?
2016 is when I left South Florida.
So I wanted to get you on the show. I've been following you for a bit now, and I had seen early on that you were on Cobra Kai when it was on YouTube.
Yep.
But recently, congratulations, by the way, picked up on a way bigger platform? I don't know.
Yeah, it's way bigger
platform. Yeah, well, I guess. Yeah, right? Netflix? It's dominating the fucking game. Just got picked up by Netflix. John, what do you think about that, dude?
It's huge. I'll be honest with you. One of the biggest things, to be honest, is the fact that the show is finally getting the recognition I think it deserves. I mean, it's a really good show. I mean, both seasons were just really well done.
Yeah.
And the guys that are behind it, you know, I don't know if you know this, but they were the guys behind Harold and Kumar Go to White Castle.
No, I did not know
that. Yeah, that was their first sort of big, you know, they wrote that.
I can tell within the opening monologue, within the opening dialogue, that it was just a different show. It's funny. And you don't get funny right off the bat with a lot of these shows. And eventually, as you get to know the characters and their mannerisms and stuff, you start buying into it. But this was funny right off the bat as he's waking up from his drunken...
Yep. and how they juxtapose it to him getting slammed in the face by the crane kick.
Yes.
You know, back 30 years ago. And it leads right into that, you know.
I love how they spin it off, dude. So let's go back a little. Yeah. Cobra Kai is a spinoff of The Karate Kid.
Yeah, it's I think they call it like a continuation, like a continuing story.
Okay. Well, yeah, it didn't spin off to any other story. It just continued if Ralph Macchio would have would, you know, just grown up in the valley, his life with his family, and then what's his name? I'm sorry,
Billy Zabka. Yeah, William Zabka, who plays Johnny.
Johnny, which was his arch nemesis, if you will, in The Karate Kid, just kind of his whole life just spiraled out of control, not a very present father. And in episode two, an inspector walks in, Keith, I believe his name is, and here walks in this man that I did comedy with for a few years, and I'm like, are you fucking kidding me?
All right, just do some crunches. Yeah. Don't you have gym class or something?
Yeah.
Okay. Howdy there, Mr. Lawrence.
It's Sensei.
Miguel, shut up. What brings you in? Looking to lose that gut and learn how to kick some ass?
No. I'm from the city health department. It's a list of requirements needed to open up an exercise studio.
This isn't an exercise studio. This is a karate dojo.
Yeah, same deal. Wow. This place needs a lot of work. You're not open for business, are you? You a customer here?
Oh, no, that's just an illegal I picked up this morning. He's helping me set up.
I don't need to know about all that. My job is just to make sure this place is up to code. You don't want a scabies outbreak like that hot yoga place over on Tahunga.
Wait. So I have to do all this crap before I even open?
No, you need to do all that to get the certificate that's required to get the insurance you need to open. But you knew that when you signed your lease, right?
Right, yeah.
I'll drop in next week for another inspection. Cool rattlesnake.
It's a cobra.
Oh, right. Duh. I'm such an idiot. Cobra K.
Killing the fucking game. Are we not there, John? How did that happen? How did you land that one?
You know, I'll be honest with you. It was just a matter of, like, my agent reached out to me, and she's like, hey, they want you to audition, you know, for this role. And I knew kind of what, it had been talked about what they were doing, right? But you didn't, obviously you didn't know the scope of it. You know, when you're an actor and you're auditioning, you only get a very small part of the script. Right. It's called side, basically what they give you. So it's a scene or a couple lines. And, but so I didn't know the whole scope of it. And I was like, okay, they're redoing the Karate Kid or they're continuing, like whatever that's going to be.
Right.
And it was funny because there was another South Florida actor who I knew for a very long time. We actually went to school together, happened to be up in Atlanta at the same time, and he got the same audition. So we're like, let's shoot it together. So we both shot the auditions together. And then I got called in for the callback and met the guys, you know, all the guys, John and Hayden, and they were there and they loved it. I did it and they loved it and they thought it was hilarious and they were laughing in the room. And I walked out of there. I'm like, there's a good chance that I might've booked this. And there we go.
That fucking process gives me goosebumps, because how often do we go in there? And, you know, I've dabbled in it a few times, and how often do you go into an audition, you think you nailed it, they're all laughing, they're the fucking, and the moment you leave, they're like, fuck that guy.
Yeah, right. Yeah, no, it's you know, it's funny. This game, you have to be able to just kind of do it and walk away.
Do it and go have a coffee and forget about it.
You don't even remember what you did 10 Absolutely. Minutes ago because, you know, it's all rejection. I mean, it's all rejection. And if you think about it too much, it'll kill you. So you do your thing, you do the best that you can do. And you walk away from it. And if it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, it doesn't. There's always another one. So.
Well, let me tell you something, man. I watched the show, and specifically that scene. You know, you look at it with a bit of a filter because I know you. And so, but it didn't take anything from the performance. I thought you nailed it. You were very cold, but yet, you know, funny. What did you say at the end? Cobra K.
Cobra K, yeah.
Cobra K, you know. Even your exit was funny. How was it working with Johnny? With the
he was great.
His name is Johnny.
He was great. So I worked with Johnny, and I worked with Sholo, who played, you know, the kid that's on there. It was his protege, and it was a wonderful experience. And what's really sort of funny about the whole thing is that was really my first kind of big
role
that I had booked. I booked something earlier that was I played a bartender on like an ID channel murder show where I was like that, you know, all knowing bartender, like, you know,
been in the Peterson trial.
No, that was this was a little bit before that. This was on a swamp murders episode on ID channel, but I was the guy when the cops come in there like, hey, you remember this girl from the other night? And I'm like, oh yeah, I remember her. You know, like there's that whole bit that what's his face? Yeah. It's like, so I give them all the information.
Yeah. Yeah.
But that was my first booking when I got to Atlanta. And this was like probably my third, but this was like really the first big, you know, show. Like I showed up at 6 o'clock in the morning because it's shot on a soundstage. And excuse me. And I go to check in and I'm talking to the PA that's checking me in, and we're doing all this kind of stuff. And she's like, okay, well, we'll take you to your trailer. And I'm like, my what?
You're like,
and she's like, your trailer.
Traitor.
I'm like, oh yeah, my trailer, of course, my trailer. That's super cool. And so we walk, and I've got this trailer, and it's got a whole thing set up. And I'm like taking pictures inside because it's the coolest thing I've ever done in my entire life.
Right, without anyone seeing, but you're fine.
Right, exactly. And I'm trying to play it cool. I'm like, yes, right. Of course, my trailer. I'm like, I hope it's stocked with Dom Perignon, of course. But you know,
some cigars, please.
Right, exactly.
Yeah. So did that shoot in Atlanta? Because I know everything's, that's like the hub now. Or was it, did you have to go to LA at all? No.
They actually, the whole show was shot in Atlanta. They only really shot the exterior shots in LA to make it look like LA.
Here.
Yeah.
I keep hearing about Atlanta being that hub.
It is.
And you know, they do, I see it. They do it all the time. Even Miami shows, they fly a drone over here. They get some of the B-roll shit, and then they go in, back to fucking somewhere in Ohio and film the rest of the show. But that's, I guess Atlanta has become that spot then, huh?
It has. I mean, Atlanta, you know, Georgia did a really smart thing when they instituted their tax credits, which right. a lot of other states did. Florida did it too, and North Carolina and Louisiana. But they tied it into a lot of local businesses so that a lot of local businesses had a stake in the game. So, right. so a lot of the main, you know, there's a lot of major businesses here. Home Depot is here. Chick-fil-A is here. UPS is here. You know, there's a lot of major local, you know, businesses that are headquartered. So they didn't want the entertainment industry to leave here because they were benefiting from it, the right. way they structured the tax breaks. So it kind of made it, it was really smart just to kind of keep everyone here. And then really everything just kind of coalesced around Atlanta, like back in like 2015, 2016, everything was just like, all right, this is where it's going to be in the Southeast.
And for everything, because it has a strong music game out there too. I know that trap started there.
Yeah, the trap house.
That's right. Is that pink house out there somewhere?
It's out there. Yeah, it's out there. So I was actually pretty close to where I used to live when I first moved to Atlanta.
Oh shit! So you're pretty gangster. You're pretty gangster.
Don't I look totally gangster? I'm like OG. Over here,
I can see. You actually look like you're in a hostage situation the way you're set up right now, dude. So gangster you are.
I just want to say something to my family.
Dude, John, so tell me about your role as one of the McDonald's brothers. Now, The Founder has become one of my favorite movies. Dude, it's such a good fucking movie. It has the entrepreneurship, the struggle, eventual fuck over with the handshake, and then the whole Ray Kroc thing. But you play on the History Channel, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
Dick McDonald.
Yep.
How was that, dude?
That was awesome. I mean, that was really and that kind of came about. It was a really weird situation how that all kind of started. I was so I have an agent here in Atlanta, and that's their job is to go out and pitch me to, you know, whatever, and get auditions.
Be your bitch.
Well, no, we're a team. We're a partnership. I love them to death, and they're fantastic. And I've been with them since I got here, and So I was scrolling through Backstage, which is the industry magazine where they post castings and that kind of stuff. And
not to be confused with Backpage, but yes.
No, yes, right. Not Backpage, right? which I also scroll through.
Not
so much anymore since they got rid of that whole section.
Right, you're doing good now. You're doing good. Right.
Yeah. I mean, 2015 back then, doesn't matter. Anyway, so.
Yeah.
So anyway, so I'm scrolling through, and there's a posting, and it's really cryptic. It's about looking, you know, they're casting something for historical figures. They don't say what it is. They just, you know, say they're looking for people of sort of this age and this ethnicity and this, you know. And I was like, okay, that just kind of fits me. So I send it in, and then I get this casting back, and I'm like, we want you to audition for these roles. And it was I actually auditioned for both McDonald's brothers, which
really.
I didn't look like a tall, bald guy, but whatever. They wanted, I guess, just wanted to see what I could do.
I mean, and, yeah.
And then one of the, I think Henry Hines was the other. And I got my agent involved, and I was like, hey, I just got this, you know, whatever. And she got involved. But, and I did it, and I sent it off. And then I get this email back, like, I don't know, maybe a week later. And they're like, all right, they loved you. We want to book you. You got to go to New York. We're flying to New York. And you got 4 shoot days on it, and it's over the course of a month, so we're flying you back and forth. And at first I was like, is this legit? Is this a scam? Like, what's it? You know what I mean? It was just such a weird thing that it was like on Backstage, and it didn't, but it turned out that, I mean, obviously it was legit. It was the History Channel, and they were shooting it all over New York State because they needed all these sort of like historical looking locations.
Right.
And, and it was, I was actually talking to the casting director who cast it. And I said something, I basically said something to the effect of like, why am I here from Atlanta? You know, you're in New York. Like, you've got tons of actors here in New York. Why would you fly me here?
Right.
And he was like, it was a network choice, actually. They loved you at the network, which was A&E Networks. And they're like, they were like, you're the guy. So get that guy. And I was like, okay, sounds good.
That's how it works sometimes, dude.
That's how it works sometimes. And you know, like we were talking earlier, you do your thing, and you wash your hands of it, and you walk away. And sometimes it happens, and sometimes it doesn't. But you know,
I've been on so many of those that you think you almost want to say like, dude, I promise you, I'm the perfect fit for this shit. Like, they describe me. You know what I'm saying? And then you go in there, and you. you do the audition and you think that, you know, you said something kind of quirky to the casting director, and you know, you think I might be memorable, and then you never fucking hear from them. And right. Yeah, I guess you do have to build that thick skin. I mean, coming from stand-up, I'm sure that helps, but it just sucked, man. To, you know, I've done it so often. I did this one, I guess we all start off in some like fucking I played this guy on Tammany Hall, I believe her name is, on a cold case, a lawyer from Miami that his son shot his mother. I don't know if he adopted him or if it was his biological son, but anyway, he grows up, he murders the mom, he shoots the lawyer in the face, his father, but he doesn't die. And I play that character, you know, going up the stairs, and it's a trip because you shoot so much for these scenes, and then you and you see maybe my shoulder and my back hair, right? Maybe. And then there's a scene where I'm talking to my friend about the murder or whatever. And I'm like, dude, that's at least like 5 minutes of fucking FaceTime right there. Yeah, and then you see it, and it's the shadow behind a fucking wall, behind a column.
Yeah.
And you're in a room with all your friends, like, all right, guys, let's call it a night. Let's get the fuck out of here.
And the worst part is you're telling all your friends, you're like, hey, I'm going to be in this thing. Check it out. And then you're out of here. It's like, yeah, did you see the side of my face? Like, look how good that looked. I was moisturizing right
before. That was amazing. Dude, I did a Rock of Ages.
Oh, cool.
I for some reason, the Brian Singer, I think his name was, he saw me, he picked me, and he goes, you're going to be a bartender. And I was like, all right, I guess. You know, it was a period piece, so I had to be shaved. Right. They did my hair a little bit. I was in a vest, the Biltmore. I saw Catherine Zeta-Jones and Bryan Cranston. It was a fucking trip.
Nice.
And I'm there, and he has a dolly that's driving up with the camera up to Catherine Zeta-Jones and Bryan Cranston. And I'm on the side of the dolly, and he comes behind me, and he puts his hands on me, and he goes, all right, when I push you, cross in front of the camera. The dolly's going to be like midway up to them. I'm going to call you back. You cross again. And I was basically a fucking deer. I played a deer. And so I was just crossing roads. Right. And so eventually I did it. And and I did it slow enough. And I ducked and I got a little lower so the camera really gets a good face shot. And I told my friends about this. I remember going with my girl and my friend Bert to the movie theaters. Dude, all you see is my fucking shoulder for a millisecond.
And the shoulder's even blurry.
It's blurry. It's like, get the fuck, I want to see Brian, you shoulder. Who's the shoulder that keeps hogging up? And I was so disappointed. I've never told anyone that because I'm not really in it. Right. And it's like, dude, those are the slaps in the face that when these actors do make it, you could understand why they go a little fucking...
But here, listen, trust me, I've learned... I don't say anything to anybody until I fucking see it. Or unless I know I have a line that's not going to be cut because it's important to the story.
Right.
I fucking say a word, not a word.
What, I don't know if you're able to say it, but what have you auditioned for that you, like what, has there been like a big role that you're like, holy fuck. And then you see it later and you're like, I could have been fucking Heath Ledger in Joker.
Yeah, close. It was close to that. But actually, it's funny. So I auditioned for a role in Stranger Things, the last season of Stranger Things.
Really?
And I did the audition, and it was a fairly extensive audition. Like, it wasn't just, you know, like one line or two lines. So, you know, there was some meat there. And I did it, and I was happy about it, and I sent it off and kind of forgot about it. And then... Stranger Things, I didn't book it, obviously. And then Stranger Things came out. I was watching it. And then I caught the scene that was the audition was from. And I was like, holy fuck. And it was like this really big character that they gave to a bigger named actor. And not that I thought, to be honest, not that they would have given me that part.
Right.
Because I think they wanted somebody that was a bigger actor for it. But just the fact that they wanted to see what I would do with it. Do you know what I mean? That's kind of part of it where you know, the casting directors, let's just see what John can do with it.
Right.
Just, you know, we're not going to cast him for it, but you know, Could he play a role this big?
Well, it's not only that, but it lives within that within that community. So now they know that there's this guy that they like for a role, but it didn't really fit him maybe at the time. But hey, maybe we could book him for something else.
And that's the key. And I tell people all the time, like actors who are either just starting out or just coming up here or whatever it is, I said, really the consistency is you just, if you're consistently seen by casting directors, if they ask for you, even if you're not booking the roles,
right,
as long as they're asking for you, that's, they want to see you. Casting directors don't ask for people they don't want to see.
Right. There's something there. They're intrigued by something.
Right. They want to see how you're progressing. They want to give you harder and harder roles or see how you do harder and harder scenes, you know, just to see it, you know, because then something's going to come along and they want to book you in something. So, you know, there's the casting director that does Stranger Things and that does The Outsider and that does, and they do all the Marvel movies up here. They're a really big casting agency.
Right.
They're probably one of the biggest ones in town, I should say. And for whatever reason, I don't know, you know, how it started, but they started wanting to see me a lot. And it went on for about a year and a half, and I was always auditioning for them for all their projects that they were doing, but I was never booking anything.
Right.
And I said that to my agent, and he's like, just...
Weinstein had nothing to do with this.
Yeah, he's like, just keep doing your thing. You know what I mean? Just do, you know, it's not gonna, nothing's going to change, and you know, you're not going to be able to change anything. So I just kept doing my thing, and then all of a sudden, boom, I booked something with them. And then 3 months later, I booked something with them again. And then I just booked something with them at the beginning of this year. So it's like, you know... You just kind of get in there, and then they're like, okay, you'd be good for this, you'd be good for that, you know, and then they want to work with you, which is great.
So. Right, and you know, a lot of times, these casting directors, they have a certain idea, I'm sure, of what they're going for, but sometimes you might come out of nowhere and, you know, stun them, and you know, they could see you in that role.
And the other part of it is that, and a lot of people don't kind of see this part of it, which is, look, casting directors have a job to do. You know, they're hired by the production to cast it.
Right.
And, you know, if they put somebody in a role that doesn't work out and they have to recast it or shows up drunk on set or doesn't, you know, show up late or, you know, fucks up, you know, that reflects on them. They're the hiring manager of that part of the production. So
you should have done research a little bit, yeah.
And they want people they can trust. So once you start working with people and once you build that trust, they're like, great, we don't have to worry about this. Give it to so-and-so because we know they're going to show up. We know they're going to do a great job. We know they're not going to have a
problem. Right, right. Well, directors do that often. I mean, you see
Absolutely.
Certain directors work with certain actors over and over again. And mm-hmm. I'm sure it's because they built that trust. They built that right. muse. Yep. You know?
And they know what they can do and they know what they can give them. You know. So
what's the so now being somewhat of a seasoned actor, what is your advice for someone starting out? Because I mean, I remember being senior year looking up for roles and on Google. I mean, I did the drama class, I did all that shit. Unfortunately, I never went to college for it, but I was constantly looking for things, and after a while you do get discouraged because nobody wants to, you know, you talk to people but they want to speak to your rep. You know, oh, we don't do it like that. You have to, but how are you going to get a rep if you haven't done anything? It's almost like one of those like jobs that we're like, oh, we're seeking experience, but it's like, how the fuck am I going to get experience if I never get hired?
Right.
What's your advice to that person trying to, you know, starting out, trying to make it a little?
My advice is a couple of things. One, it's persistence. I mean, that's really, you gotta, especially when you're young, like I got into this game when I was 40. Okay. So I did some acting in high school drama and all that
kind of stuff. Yeah.
I came into stand-up comedy when I was 40. So I came into it with a bit of a different perspective than someone who's coming into it when they're 20.
Right.
So it is a little bit different, but the point is that there's a million 20-year-olds that want to be movie stars, a million of them.
Right.
And you're one of them. Like, you know, and you kind of have to, it's, you're, you know, are you going to stand out? What can you do to stand out? There's just work at it. I mean, it's a craft, like anything else, it's an art. And, you know, the more you work at it, it's, you know, what I always tell people, if you're a bodybuilder, is your work the competition or is your work the 7 days that you do in the gym for 6 months for the competition?
Right.
And the work is the 7 days a week in the gym for the 6 months.
Right.
And that's what an actor does. You're always working on your craft. You're always doing classes. You're always reading scripts. You're always reading plays. You're always breaking down characters. You're always, you know, that's where the real work comes in that you don't really see, to be honest. It's just a matter of, you know, you see the end result of it. But so it's, I'm constantly in acting classes. I'm constantly, you know, and you have to be serious about it. So when I say that, what I mean is, you got to come in with headshots. You got to come in with, you know, if you're going to go try and get an agent, you come in with headshots, because there's plenty of people that want agents out there. But right. If they see somebody serious, spend some money, went and got a photographer to do some professional headshots,
right.
They actually want to do this. They're serious.
They're serious about their craft.
Yeah, right.
They've invested in themselves, and now it's more likely that someone invests in them.
Correct.
I agree. Totally. I agree. This is great. You know, one of the things that, going back to what you said earlier, about being persistent and how bad you want it, and what is the competition? You know, I remember talking to people when I was doing the comedy thing and I started getting some popularity, about just, you know, how I stuck to it, how I kept doing it. And, you know, oh, you should move out to LA or this and that. And I remember thinking, like, you know, talking to people that, you know, are a little on the lazy side, I'm like, dude, you're saying you want this. You want to be an actor or a comedian. Everyone in fucking LA that's a barista, some that are even sleeping on bus benches, that went out there for the dream,
yep,
wanted just as bad as you. But here you are complaining about it or trying to see what's the shortcut when those people are out there with 5 cents in their pocket with the dream trying to do it, you know, eating dicks at night, and fucking bombing up the
stage. Instead of shrugging their shoulders and playing Xbox all day instead of writing jokes, there's work to be done. I mean, it's everybody sees the end result. You see the comedian, you know, you see Jerry Seinfeld on stage telling the jokes. It's like, how do I get to be that? You don't see him every day for 8 hours writing jokes on a legal pad.
Exactly. You know, or the other comics that go out there and bomb and bomb and bomb day after night after night.
5-6 shows a night, you know, that they're going from show to show to show just to get on stage.
And even actors, like what you said, I like what you said, which is, you know, people want to get to that, you know, Heath Ledger, that Joaquin Phoenix, that Daniel Day-Lewis. You know, but these people are obsessed with their craft. And what you don't see is, and some of them method actors, the year that they spent in character researching their role. You know, even before that, before they even landed a role, just doing some internal, you know, searching, some, you know, look, you know, people watching. I like to do this as an actor. I like to sometimes observe people and see what makes that person walk that way. Why are they walking like that? Yeah. Why are they talking a certain way? I do it with my characters online. You know, a lot of that was observed, was sponged, you know, by life. Just me actually meeting people that talked and looked and moved a certain way.
Yeah.
And people don't understand that there's a lot of psychology that goes behind acting.
Acting is 100% psychology. 100%. It's all psychology.
Right.
You know, it's like, you know, you're sitting the way you're sitting because of all the years that, you know, from when you were a child to this moment of who you are and what happened to you and how you know, whatever it is, I'm acting the way I'm acting because of who I am and what happened to me and all that. You know, when you're an actor, you're becoming someone else.
Right. And you have to consider those things.
That does those things, not because you're acting the way that they did those things.
Right.
You're doing those things because you're trying to put yourself into the way that they grew up and the way the influences affected them. And
one of the things that I love the most about Daniel Day-Lewis is that you could see that in every frame this guy does.
Yeah.
You know, there's something that I love, and I don't think it's talked about enough. Have you ever seen There Will Be Blood with Daniel Day-Lewis?
Yeah, one of my favorite movies.
He falls in the well. He falls in the oil pit or whatever, and he fucks up his leg. And if you watch, if you keep that in mind as he did as an actor, that injury progresses to the point that later on in life he has a limp. He kind of, you know, I'll drink my milkshake or whatever. He's almost kind of, but that all stemmed from him falling when he was a younger guy. Right. That was a character choice.
Because that's real. Because that's what happens.
And exactly, 110%. Yeah. And that could be overseen. I don't know if... I would like to see if that was in the script or said as a director, or if he himself, which I'm sure he did, said, you know what, I'm going to now that injury I'm going to keep in mind, and, you know, it's going to progress as I get older, which I'm sure he did. You know what I'm saying? And I mean, that's what I think makes a badass actor.
And that's the thing. I mean, he obviously he's on a whole nother level. Yeah. He's a yes. You know, but that's, I mean, and that's the thing between bad acting and good acting. You know, but you know, bad acting is, you know, showing what you want the audience to see. Showing
the Reeves in Lake House.
I'm not going to say anything bad. You never know when someone's talking.
Yeah, I know.
But you know, I read something, you know, the other day that said, you know, as an actor, you don't want to show your emotion because to the audience or to what you're doing, because in real life, people don't show their emotions; they try to hide them.
That's smart.
And as an actor, you have to feel the emotion and just let it live inside of you.
I heard something about, I think it was Robert De Niro that said something similar to that, which was sometimes less is more.
Oh, it's all 100%.
If you're feeling anger or some of that, no one's ever really like, I mean, there's few cases, but even those people are fucking lunatics, but you know, no one's like huffs and puffs, right, like when they're mad, just,
I'm mad.
Right. Yeah. And they kick rocks. And
nobody does that.
Most of us internalize those things, and
right, you try not to blow up, and you see it building.
You see your eyes water, and your face.
That's what makes it interesting, and it makes it interesting because the audience has to interpret that, and then their mind is working.
Yes.
You show it to them; they don't care. They're just sitting there,
It's there.
Like, wait a minute, what's going on in there? Is he mad? Does he love that person? You know, there's you got to draw that audience in. It's like a book. I mean, you've got to put it in their imagination.
It's like when you go to a strip club and all these women are naked, but your eyes are focused on the waitress.
Well, right. Who's not naked? That's a funny analogy, but a perfect analogy.
You know what I'm saying?
Because it's what you can't see. It's you know, yeah. Okay. You're giving it to me. That's fine.
Yeah. You know? It's great. Yeah. You know, tits ass on this, but right. What's under that thing? Like that's,
yeah,
that's the human nature.
Why are you not giving it up? Like, exactly. I want what I can have.
What's behind the curtain?
That's right. I do love big tits, by the way.
Just for the record. Right. Do you say that at any castings in what you end?
It depends on the characters I'm playing. I mean, I was just telling my roommate, who's another actor, that I had an audition for Ozark a couple of years
ago. Get out of here, dude.
Yeah. And
or it was Ozark, or?
What's that?
Like, was this before Ozark? Was Ozark, or was
this season two? I think.
Oh, okay. Wow.
So, and I was reading in the audition. I was reading a Hustler magazine because I was playing this guy that was like the front desk guy at a seedy motel, and I was like, this guy would be reading a Hustler magazine. Like, that's what, you know, this guy's not reading Time magazine. He's reading Hustler. You know?
Right.
So I bought a Hustler magazine, which, to be honest, if you ever try to find like analog pornography nowadays, really? It's not that easy.
I'm sure it's not.
Yeah, like I was going to gas station. I'm like, do you have any like adult magazines? They're like, you mean like Newsweek? I'm like, no, not like Newsweek.
If you were a creep back then asking for that, now in 2020, right, asking for that, you are a serial killer, dude.
Oh, yeah, totally. It's just a prop for a movie. It's fine.
Like, sure, you creep. Sure. What the fuck? Just look it up like the rest of us online.
Right. Yeah, no, we're not taking cash out of your hand, buddy.
Do you leave it on the counter? Do you do that though? Because you hear actors do that they know that the role, I like that it's gonna be like a slimy dude or a very preppy dude. Like they go in there, you know, already dressed a certain way or reading a certain thing. Like, is that a thing to go in there?
Yeah, I mean,
already in somewhat character.
A lot of actors do it. I don't necessarily do the whole dressing part. I'll do it. I do it more like when I want to work on accents. Not necessarily maybe for something specific, but just like, you know, I want to work on an accent. So I'll go to Publix and I'll speak in an English accent the whole time I'm at Publix.
Get or, you know, you really like, do that?
Like, like a Boston accent or something, just to kind of work on it, see if really? I can pass it off and speak as if it was just, this is how I talk, you know, because that's the other part.
And then you go back to that same Publix a week later and confuse all the cash.
All the people, right. So, you know what I mean? But I'm like, I don't care, whatever.
It's only when he buys iced tea that he puts on that southern accent.
Pardon me, hello. You know, but it's
So what do you got going on next, man? What are you getting into?
So next, well, so the last thing that came out was the History Channel show that you talked about.
Right.
But after you shot a movie with Kelsey Grammer and Sean Astin.
Wow.
And that was end of last year. Now, I don't know where that is as far as when it's coming out or if it's done.
Right.
Who knows? But it was a period piece from the 1960s. So I played like another 1960s type character.
So they're going to keep seeing you in these roles and you're going to be the fucking extra.
Listen, that's a good way to, I did want to make one point because you asked me about like what to tell actors who are trying to get into this.
Yeah.
You have to kind of make a distinction whether or not you're looking to be an actor or a celebrity.
Okay.
Because they're two really different things.
I agree.
And if you're looking to be a celebrity, get yourself a TikTok and start doing stupid shit. You'll be famous. You know what I mean? Like, but if you want to be an actor and you want to work, you know, and make a career out of it, that's a whole different ballgame. It's a job. Sure. And you have to have a passion for it. So I think that's sort of, important to.
Not to shit on TikTokers, but yes.
No, and I'm not at all. I'm just
50,000 followers, by the way, John, 50,000 followers I got, but go ahead.
Because I think people get into the game and be like, oh, I'm going to be famous. And it's like, no, if that's your goal. So it's like so many like superb actors are not celebrities, and they work every day and they're such great actors that you wouldn't even know who they are. And then there's so many actors who are just, they're mediocre actors, but they're famous.
But that's just a more fulfilling life. You know, if you could, like right now I do comedy full time. I've gotten to a point where I could live off of doing what I do, the skits, the podcast, and that for me, I don't have the fame or the celebrity, whatever the fuck, but it's such a fulfilling life that everything I have is bought with comedy money.
Absolutely.
That I am, if I get there, that's cool. But if I don't, I still, to a degree, I'm still successful. I feel fulfilled that I get to do what I knew I wanted to do since I was a little kid for a living.
You're making a living at something that you love, that you truly love, that you did for free, and you're making a living.
Many nights.
And I think that's something to be celebrated. And that's, I think that's a wonderful thing. And congratulations on that, because it's such a hard, people don't realize how hard of a thing that is to do.
It's almost impossible to be like,
nowadays,
I mean, there's I went through some different avenues I never even fathomed when I was younger, that are, accessible now and you could tap into now. And if you work it right, you can make some money, but it's definitely, it's same principle. You need patience. You need determination. You need to, and like Steve Jobs says, be a little bit crazy, because you're going to keep getting the same result. You're going to keep sucking for a long time. It's going to happen. I was just watching Joe Rogan talking about his first few years in podcasting. He was getting like 100-200 hits from time. Fucking Joe Rogan, he was already a name, but who gives a shit about him talking for an hour or two to random people? He was getting like 200. So that same principle in the entertainment business is, applies for all of us. Patience, what is it? Patience is a virtue. That's absolutely true. You have to be patient, because it's gonna suck for a long fucking time. And now I just want to touch on one last thing, dude. You said you entered the, though you've been doing this on and off, and you were doing the stand-up, which, by the way, are you still doing the stand-up?
I'm actually not. It got a little too much between the acting and the stand-up, just obviously, grinding around, getting on stage late at night, that kind of stuff. So I still write jokes because I still love doing it, so I'll get on an open mic every now and again, just hop on something just to tell some jokes, but I don't do it with any sort of regularity.
Okay. All right. That's fine. Yeah. I stepped away from it a little bit. But I'm, there's nothing like, and as I know you could vouch for me, there's nothing like that live fucking element, hearing no laughs. but so you said you got serious about this in your 40s.
Yeah.
Now, for a lot of people and a lot of these, you hear a lot of people talk shit about ageism in Hollywood and getting into certain things at a certain age. And, by this time you should be this and all this bullshit social shit. What did you think about I don't know if it was a full career change. I don't know if this is what you're doing full time. Maybe you are. What are your thoughts on getting into something like this a little later in your life? You know, you're 40. What do you think about that?
So I'll say from an acting perspective, it actually makes it a little bit easier.
Okay.
And I'll say that because, like I said, when you're in your 20s, right, there's a million 20-year-olds that want to be actors. And the ones that can kind of persist and get through and get through and get through as the pool gets smaller and smaller and smaller, the ones that are left that can act in their 40s are the ones that get cast in those roles when they need people who look a little bit older.
Right.
So it's a little bit smaller of a pool. There's not as many roles, so it kind of balances itself out. But and plus you have more life experience. You know, you kind of can you know, kind of comport yourself a little bit better, I think, you know, just more.
Well, you can pull from a lot more.
Yeah, right. You can pull for a lot more, and you're just, you know, you're I think you're more serious about things than you, you know, I just, trust me, I know I'm a lot more serious now than I was in my 20s.
Right.
I think, you know, what happened with me was, it was 2013. I was getting out of a corporate job that I'd been in since 2008. And making a ton of money with, I mean, and I thought that's what I kind of wanted, was to have the six-figure job and my house and all that kind of stuff. And I was miserable. I was absolutely miserable because the person I worked for was miserable, and I realized that it wasn't the dollar that I was chasing. Just making money didn't do anything for me, didn't fulfill me really in any way. And then when that ended in 2013, I kind of sat down and I said, okay, I'm 40 years old. If I could just right now say, this is what I want to do, what would that thing be?
Okay.
And it was stand-up comedy and acting. I mean, that's what, those are the two things that came out of my mouth. Wow. And I said, okay, then that's what I'm going to do. And listen, I do well at acting. I mean, I do, you know, I make money off of it. Right. Do I still do side gigs for other stuff? Absolutely.
And so right.
That's, you know, but it's something that, you know, like stand-up comedy, I would do for free because I love. I just love doing it. I love being another character. I love reading scripts. I love breaking down characters. I love getting into stories and all that kind of stuff. And so, you know, it's, I think if, I don't care how old you are, if it's something you want to do, fucking do it.
I'm with you, dude.
You get one go around on this thing. You know what I mean?
I've had people tell me the same shit, like, you know, you're approaching 30, you know, you're 30 now, you're going to be 35, you're going to be, you know, and for me, I'm like, dude, this is a book. Stop trying to make life a chapter. You know what I'm saying? This whole experience is a fucking book. You know, as cliche as that sounds, but it's like, it's not over until you close it, dude. It's not over. You could, if you want to fucking get into acting like Danny Trejo, I believe that was like 70 when he got into it. Why not? He's had a better career than most 20-year-olds.
Exactly 35, but he looks 70. So that was...
it's a different... Hollywood's rough. But I'm with you, dude. I don't see it like that. And though maybe there's a little bit of prejudice to certain ages or whatever, of breaking in or whatever, but the truth is that, you know, if you're... Like, going back to what you said originally, which is if you're in it for the acting part of acting... then it doesn't matter. If you get a role that you think you could fucking totally kill, it doesn't matter if you're 45. Even if you're younger, you know, those I honestly think the roles get more interesting the older you get.
100%. You're not playing some shirtless beach dude that's like, what's up? You know, you're,
right.
You're in depth roles.
And I also, I've noticed myself in little things that I've done, even in the characters that I do online that have caught traction, I wouldn't have been able to do a lot of those things if I didn't have life experience.
That's right.
Experiences. You know what I'm saying? Honestly, I tried to do short films in my early 20s. I just, looking back at it, I honestly felt like an empty vessel. Like, I'm saying these lines, but I feel no substance to them.
They have no meaning to you, right?
I'm detached from
that. Nothing to draw on, right?
There's nothing to draw on. And I would hear that, you know, because... as actors and shit like that, you've researched other actors and their path and their biography and, you know, who was where at what age. And I kept hearing that early on that, you know, you need to draw from these experiences. You need to tap into a certain part of you, that experience a certain thing in life that relates to the situation. And that I didn't have that younger, I honestly didn't, me personally. And I feel now at 30 with a kid, you know, fucking bombing on stage, having, you know, problems at work, at home, and in life, and health problems, and this, that now you look at a role, and when someone, you know, you could add the life in a role. You understand it now?
100%. I agree with you 100%.
So
it makes all the difference. I mean, that's what brings, that's what makes a character alive. It makes them real.
And that's, you know? And that's the part that, in drama class, it was too fucking dramatic for me. All these bitches are singing and shit, and it doesn't make any sense to me. But what I liked was when we got to that part of the psychology behind, like, study someone, and maybe you could add that to your character. I love that because it made, you know, there's a little bit of, like, you almost feel, I hate to say it, but a little pretentious or a little fake when you're doing some of these activities and stuff like that. You're like, it's a little silly. But what made it real for me, almost scientific, was, oh no, this is like a social psychology experiment. Like, this is some psychological shit that you have to tap into yourself. And in turn, it becomes almost spiritual that you, these words are just.
My acting teacher, he puts together these things where he talks about the human brain and the consciousness and where we store memories and images and what we connect to and how that works. And you know, when you hear things that connect to you personally, you know, that it bypasses your you know, consciousness through your subconsciousness and goes into your stored memory and pulls something out instantaneously that brings back a memory that lights you up. And and as an actor, you have to put those memories of the character that he had into you.
Right.
And you know, and be able to have those same reactions as if it was a natural thing. It's all imagination. It's all playing pretend. I mean, that's what it is. But you have to be fully immersed in it and be able to operate in that world. Because the other part of it is that, you know, you're on set and there's a camera 4 feet away from you and 75 people standing behind it staring at you.
Oh,
you
know? And grip guy is hungry as fuck to go cut to break and
fucking
up your line.
Okay, now it's your turn to make sure this all works.
And then you, dude, I remember one of the first time I realized that about acting and about, you know, scenes and life in general was in drama class when there was a scene that something happened before I walked in. And I remember the direction was, there is a huge fight, but that's still in the air. You can sense it when you walk in. And in my head, I'm like, what the fuck are you talking about? You could sense it.
Right.
But you don't realize that in real life. How often does that happen when you walk into a room and it feels a little weird? You know, someone said some dumb shit to somebody else and you pick up, but you don't realize it. And in fact, it's kind of like, it makes you observe life differently. You know, because I felt like, honestly, until that moment, I just felt like you're just going through life. You know, you're just in it. But, you know, thinking back on it now, that was one of the first moments that I realized, like, oh, you could detach yourself
as
an observer.
So Uta Hagen, who's a very famous acting teacher, and you're a young actor or whatever, you're getting into it, read her book because it's fantastic.
Okay.
She talked about self-observation. When you're in a situation and something happens or you're acting a certain way, stop and think about why you're acting that way. Stop and think about what happened that made you act that way. Stop and think about what you felt when that whatever happened to make you have this response to it, and understand those feelings about yourself and understand how those emotions hit you and understand how those outside influences affect you. And it's all about that self-observation, because you're right. And the reason that you don't realize it, like you said, you do that all the time, you don't think about it, is because that's just who you are. You know, you don't think, you know, I don't get out of bed every morning and think about how I'm going to be Jon Levine.
I'm brushing my teeth.
I brush my teeth because that's the way I've always fucking brushed
right,
my teeth.
Right,
you know?
And if I get casted to play your life, now I got to observe the, it's funny because it's even like in impressions, like voice impersonators, like you don't know you have a certain tone until someone tries to impersonate your voice and you're like, what the fuck? I don't talk like that. But everybody's like, dude, you sound just like him.
Right.
That observation
that and mannerisms and the little tics and the things, you know, all those little things that everybody does.
I love that.
And you don't even think about it because that's just who you are. And when you're an actor, that's what takes the life of the character off of the page, because it's just a printed page. And you have to take that and put it inside of you. And that's what being an actor is.
So when you get a role, what's your first approach to dissecting the character? You know, and what do you, how far do you get into it? You know, how do you tell yourself, okay, I found this guy. I found who this guy is.
You know, sometimes it just kind of happens. I mean, sometimes you're just like, you just get it, you know. Other times you don't get it until the camera rolls, and then all of a sudden it just kind of clicks. So, but really when you get a role or you get, you know, I read the script a lot. So I'll read the script a few times sort of from different perspectives. So I'll read it just straight through just to read it. And then I'll read it as if I was the audience watching this, and I'm like, what's happening in this scene, and what's, you know, what's going on between these people. And then you read it from the character's perspective, and then you read it, you know, so you just kind of keep going through it. And then you read not the dialogue, but the stage directions. So to see what's going on around everybody. And then, you know, what happened before the scene started, what's going to happen after the scene started, you know, or after the scene ends, you know, all those different types of things. And then you have to find clues. It's called breaking down a script. And so you look for different clues to who the character is based on either what they say, what the conflicts are in the scene, what, you know, the relationships that they have with the people that they're talking to, how they're talking, if it talks about how they're dressed or how they're acting, or, you know, where everything's set. I mean, you know, it's all those, there's all these like little different, and that's what you learn. And listen, I'm not, you know, it's probably coming off like I'm some fucking master thespian. I'm not.
No, not at all, dude.
These are things that I've learned in acting class.
I don't know, but you've had the experience.
The last few years.
And, exactly. Yeah. And that's worth something, you know? Yeah.
But that's what you do. So you get in there, and then you start to build almost like a, you know, a buddy of mine likes to do this, like what he calls the why exercise. It's like, okay, you know, he's acting this way. Why? Well, probably because he had a tough childhood. Why? Well, maybe his father didn't show him enough love.
Right.
Maybe his father was an alcoholic. Why? You know, and he kind of keeps breaking down these questions to get down, you know, it's all about the specific, very specific. Acting is detail. It's very specific detail. It's not just like, oh, a guy walks into a room and he smiles. It's why is he walking into the room? Why is he smiling? Who else is in the room, and what is he smiling at?
Yeah. I mean,
there's all these very specific that you have to understand. You know, an acting teacher will always, you'll say something or you'll say a line, and an acting teacher will stop you and say, why did the character say that?
Why? I know.
Why? Why did that character say that? Just, you know, and you think about it, and you're like, I didn't even think about that. And it's like, well, but you need to, you know, there's a motivation why you say everything.
Right, because
it doesn't just come out.
If the character's saying it to piss you off, that's going to come off a different way than if he's saying it to turn you on, or if he's saying it to be dismissive. You know,
and it could be the same line. It could be the same. You know, you could say I love you 10 different ways, and it means 10 different things.
Absolutely, absolutely, yeah. and that's what I found so interesting about acting, and one of the reasons why I love it.
Me too. You know? The same way, and I geek out on that shit. I get into it, and I geek out on it, and really just, you know.
Well, gets me sometimes, and I don't know if it happens to you, sometimes you read a line, and you're like, oh, I've never said that word in my life. Like I've never called my girlfriend honey. And then you come across that line, and you're like, hey, honey, can you pass? And I almost trip up on that, because I'm like, how do I make that sound like me?
Right.
Like, how do I get that and turn it into, you know, obviously you have to study the character and immerse yourself into it. But it's sometimes you bump into the dialogue that you're like, oh man, I've never said that shit in my fucking life.
Right.
How do you
need to now?
Right. How do you tap into crossing over some of those pauses or weird words that you've never used in your fucking life to now it be a part of your,
I try to equate them to things is what I try to do. So it's like, I'll try to think of what I would have said for the same meaning, for that same feeling. Okay. So because there's a lot of, you know, when what you learn as an actor is just, you don't want to focus on the lines. The lines are fairly meaningless in the sort of the larger picture of the emotion and the meat of the scene and all that kind of stuff. So it's more about the feelings, and it's more about the undercurrents of what's actually happening, because every scene has a subtext, and every scene is, you know, is really telling a different story. There's multiple stories being told.
You just take the word with you.
Yeah. So I think when you kind of just look at it and be like, well, why is the person saying that? Why is he saying, okay, honey, I think that's a great idea. Are they saying that because they truly mean that? Are they saying that because they're pissed at that person and they're just trying to think it? Are they trying to get under the, you know, whatever that is. And you think, okay, well, if I was doing that, I would do this. And then you just get that feeling, and then you know how to say it, because it's not necessarily the words themselves. It's the feeling behind it.
Right.
So.
Jon Levine, dude, thank you so much for being on, man. Honestly, this got, this went a little longer than I thought. I geeked out with all this, with his acting techniques, and dude, thank you. Thank you so much, man. It was a pleasure.
Hey, and don't edit this down to just my shoulder passing in front of the screen. Hey, Jon Levine was on it with us.
Another credit gone.
That's right. Damn it.
No, man, this was awesome. And again, dude, congratulations on all your success, man. And everything you're going to continue to do. Hopefully I'll look back at this in 5 years and be like, I fucking interviewed that guy, man. We talked. I knew him.
Hopefully we'll be co-starring in something. That's what you got to look at.
That's the plan, dude. Listen, Atlanta's a lot closer than fucking Los Angeles. So
a lot closer.
Maybe I'll make my way over there, man. So Jon Levine, thank you so much for being on the podcast, man. Continue success and much love, dude.
I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
I'll see you on the next one, bro.
Take care.